Greetings. There is a man, now dead, who has largely shaped the modern teachings of Islam. No, not Muhammad, Ahmed, as in Ahmed Deedat. Ahmed Deedat wrote a pamphlet called Combat Kit Against Bible Thumpers. If you debate or argue against Islam, you will hear silly things from this pamphlet and wonder to yourself, who would come up with garbage like that? The answer is Ahmed Deedat. I'm not sure how long it will take, but I'd like to address each point in Deedat's combat kit. If you look on the web, there are no doubt several excellent refutations of the combat kit already. I would immediately look for answeringislam.org. And as with much of the interaction between Christians and Mohammedans, it is the same dialogue that has transpired since Muhammad first created his religion. As Solomon said, there is nothing new under the sun. Probably as soon as Muhammad made it up in the 600s, the Jews and Christians who heard it could say, "But wait, Muhammad, that does not agree with what the prophets wrote." This no doubt contributed to their rejection of the false message that Muhammad revealed. So I make no claim to be the first to refute Deedat's combat crapola, and I do not claim any of my arguments will be original. Some may be, but that is neither here nor there. An argument that factually refutes Deedat and is based on the Word of God is what matters. Deedat begins with point 1, AIDS and homosexuality. Deedat writes, "The Holy Bible gives the cause of this cancer and blight." And then Deedat quotes Romans 1, verse 22 through 27. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own heart, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another. Men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. Deedat makes no other comment about the issue. So while Deedat calls his pamphlet for or against Bible thumpers, isn't Deedat just thumping this Bible verse? And I honestly cannot argue with the Word of God. What it says is true, and reveals much of what we see around us today. But I think the real point Deedat tried to make was to accuse the Christian church for allowing homosexuality in the church, because that is literally condemned in the Bible. And on this one point, Deedat is absolutely correct. Liberal denominations are in direct violation of the Word of God for allowing practicing homosexuality in the membership, to say nothing of allowing the leadership to be in active, open sin. But my answer to Deedat's charge is that the Word of God condemns such acts, and to disobey the Word of God does not invalidate the Word of God, Mr. Deedat. It judges the followers. But the Word of God is still true. In item number 2 of Deedat's combat kit, Deedat tries desperately to inject Muhammad into several obscure references from the Old Testament. You always have to remember the reason for the lies that Islam tells. Point 2, Arabs and Arabia. In the Christian Bible, the burden upon Arabia, Isaiah 21:13. Burden equals responsibility. God has imposed on Muslims the duty to deliver his message to mankind. Isaiah mentions this after having seen the vision of the chariot of asses and a chariot of camels. Isaiah 21:7. The chariot of asses turns out to be Jesus, peace be upon him, who entered Jerusalem riding on two donkeys. Matthew 21:7. Who then was on the chariot of camels? Notice the implied insertion of someone. Who then was on the chariot of camels? And that comes from a false assertion. The chariot of asses turned out to be Jesus, peace be upon him, who entered Jerusalem riding on two donkeys. As always, never, ever, ever believe what a Mohammedan claims the Bible says. Matthew 21. And when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethpage, unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, Go into the village over against you, and straightway you shall find an ass tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. So we see from the word of God in this relaying of the account, there is a donkey and its colt, or offspring. But no mention of a chariot here. Can you see that? And if any man say aught unto you, you shall say, The Lord hath need of them, and straightway he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, And we see here that it is recorded this event is foretold by a prophet of God. Maybe, just maybe, Deedat was right. Do you think? Tell ye the daughter of Zion, Behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek, and sitting upon an ass, and a colt the foal of an ass. Wow, not only does the word of God say the event was foretold, but it also actually gives us what was said. Oh, but wait. The prophecy of this event said, Thy king cometh sitting upon an ass. But I wondered if this could be the chariot from Isaiah Deedat claims. So I looked it up, even though for a moment I thought, maybe, oh maybe, Deedat had a point. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem, see, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Zechariah 9:9. That it might be fulfilled. Tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass, and a colt, the foal of an ass. Glory to God in heaven. His word refutes the very lies Islam tells to this day. Jesus did ride on a donkey, but it was foretold and fulfilled word for word. And while I have immeasurable respect for Isaiah, this passage in Isaiah 21 was not talking of Jesus. So let's briefly look again at claim 2A of the combat kit. Isaiah mentions this after having seen the vision of a chariot of asses and a chariot of camels, Isaiah 21:7. The chariot of asses turned out to be Jesus, who entered Jerusalem riding on two donkeys. As I have just shown, this passage has nothing to do with Jesus. And this, therefore, is not a dangling passage prophesying some man of great stature. Who then was on a chariot of camels. Never, never, ever, ever trust a Mohammedan quoting from the Bible. Let's keep disproving point two from the combat kit. Arabs and Arabia. In the Christian Bible, the burden upon Arabia, burden equals responsibility. Deedat claims burden equals responsibility. I call this the Mohammedan redefinition of terms. If the actual words do not mean something that fits the purpose of inserting Muhammad, change the words or change the meaning of the words. Need another example? Deedat changes spirit to prophet to insert Muhammad as the comforter. In this case, however, Deedat redefines burden to mean responsibility, implying an honor, a noble task, a place of importance or power. But again, as usual, Deedat is completely wrong. Let's look up the passage and read in context to see what I mean. Isaiah 21:1, the burden of the desert of the sea. As whirlwinds in the south pass through, so it comes from the desert, from a terrible land. A grievous vision is declared unto me. The treacherous dealer dealeth treacherously, and the spoiler spoileth. Go up, O Elam, besiege, O Media. All the sighing thereof have I made to cease. Preparing this, I had a side thought. Whether from the Father in heaven or not, I cannot say. I cannot rule out that this treacherous spoiler is mention of Muhammad. Getting back to the point. The very first thing to notice is that Isaiah 21:1 begins the burden of the desert of the sea. And this is a grievous vision, a terrible thing, a burden. A grievous vision is declared unto me. The treacherous dealer dealeth treacherously, and the spoiler spoileth. Think about the tone of this vision. It is a burden because it is not pleasant. It mentions treachery and spoiling. Burden does not mean responsibility here. Therefore are my loins filled with pain. Pangs have taken hold upon me, as the pangs of a woman that travaileth. I was bowed down at the hearing of it. I was dismayed at the seeing of it. Can you feel the angst that Prophet Isaiah is portraying here? The pangs of a woman that travaileth. I was bowed down at the hearing of it. Pain and suffering. My heart panted. Fearfulness affrighted me. The night of my pleasure hath he turned into fear unto me. Prepare the table. Watch in the watchtower. Eat, drink, arise, ye princes, and anoint the shield. For thus saith the Lord, said unto me, Go, set a watchman, let him declare what he sees. So the watchman was sent to the wall, and what follows is what he reported when he returned. And he saw a chariot with a couple of horsemen, a chariot of asses, and a chariot of camels, and he hearkened diligently with much heed. He sees three chariots, not only the two Deedat mentions. And again, Deedat has no regard for God or God's word. Deedat really does not care what this really means. Deedat only needs two, one for Jesus and one to imply Muhammad. But there are three mentioned. One, two, three. Now I know the Quran commands us to not say three. But you know what? I frankly don't give a rat's what the Quran says. Because the Quran evidently retards people from counting past two. So we can clearly see there are three chariots mentioned in the vision. And it is obvious why Deedat needs to twist the scripture to use only two. It is also clear this is not a pleasant vision. It is not a great vision of great men of God. Jesus also did not ride a chariot into Jerusalem. So for all of you who really want the truth, you can see just what a false teacher and fraud Deedat was. And this is only point 2A. There are B and C with this item in the combat kit. The other theme you will see is that Mohammedans imagine that any mention of a camel is a mention of Muhammad. But that is just desperation grasping at straws. And he saw a chariot with a couple of horsemen, a chariot of asses, and a chariot of camels. And he hearkened diligently with much heed. And he cried, A lion! My lord, I stand continually upon the watchtower in the daytime, and I am set in my ward whole nights. And behold, here cometh a chariot of men and a couple of horsemen. And he answered and said, Babylon is fallen, and all the graven images of her gods he hath broken unto the ground. Ooh, a chariot. And then we learn the reason why troops are passing by. Babylon is fallen. And here is a verse with a chariot and horsemen, but it cannot be twisted because it has no camel. I bet Deedat would walk a mile for a camel. O my threshing and the corn of my floor, that which I have heard of the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, have I declared unto you. The burden of Duma. He calleth to me out of Seir, Watchman, what of the night? Watchman, what of the night? This is another segment, the burden of Duma. The watchman said, The morning cometh, and also the night. If you will inquire, inquire ye. Return, come. And that is it. No chariots to ride, no camels to twist. The burden upon Arabia, in the forest of Arabia, shall you lodge, O ye traveling companies of Dedanim. And here we finally get to the burden of Arabia. Remember, Deedat tries to redefine burden as responsibility, like this is their honor to carry the Quran to the world. God has imposed on Muslim the duty to deliver his message to mankind. But this burden is not a responsibility for Arabia. It is a message, a warning against, almost a curse. Pay attention to the burden pronounced against Arabia. For they fled from the swords, from the drawn sword, and from the bent bow, and from the grievousness of war. It is talking about required hospitality for those fleeing from the end of Babylon. For thus hath the Lord said unto me, within a year, according to the years of an hireling, and all the glory of Kedar shall fail. And all the glory of Kedar shall fail. Remember what this says about Kedar. These are not happy words for Kedar. And the residue of the number of archers, the mighty men of the children of Kedar, shall be diminished. For the Lord God of Israel hath spoken it. I repeat, these are not happy words for Kedar. And remember, this is the verse that Deedat tries to hang his hat on for telling Muhammad. So Deedat found four words and knew they must refer to Muhammad. The burden of Arabia. And this is a reasonable place to stop this video. But before I do, I have to ask you something. If you are a Christian, can you see just what lies and false claims Islam makes? Can you see why you must never ever accept what a Mohammedan says the Bible says? Deedat makes up this crap from little more than four words and mention of a camel. And if you wear the label of Muslim, do you have any regard for God? I mean, sincerely, are you able to comprehend and understand the message of this video that proves just how wrong Deedat was? Because honestly, once Christians and even atheists know just how false Deedat's claims are, pulling out ideas from Deedat's combat kit will be like bringing a bowl of hummus to a gunfight. So I ask again, do you have any regard for God? Because God Almighty, who gave Isaiah the vision, God Almighty, who gave Zechariah the prophecy of Jesus on a donkey, God Almighty, who sent his son to ride on the donkey and to die on the cross, God Almighty wants you to respect him and respect his word. And more than that, God wants to be your redeemer. God wants you to accept the sacrifice his son made to redeem you, my friend. The choice comes down to whether you respect God or not. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.